exams, comps, quals, qualifying exams, comprehensive exams, they go by many names. But today we are going to discuss what exactly are PhD exams and how do they work. So if you're interested in learning more about PhD comprehensive exams and the process of taking exams while in your PhD, then this video is for you. Hello everyone and welcome back to my channel where we talk about everything grad life, grad advice, and research. And there are just so many important milestones that go into your PhD process. And I even have a couple of videos talking about them more specifically. But today we are really getting into the nitty-gritty details of one in particular, and that is your PhD comprehensive exams. So what are PhD comprehensive exams? Well, they go by two names generally. They're known as qualifying exams or comprehensive exams. They also have shorter nicknames, like I said, quals and comps. But generally, these are kind of the middle point of your PhD process, right after you've completed all of your coursework, but right before you're able to go venture off into field work and start your dissertation. And this point of your PhD process is really important because you're transitioning from being a student to being your own independent researcher. So your PhD comprehensive exams are really a form of assessment to gauge the knowledge that you have about your field and your discipline to make sure that you are as prepared as possible for your research. Now, they can take different forms. In some cases, people may only have written exams. In other cases, people may have oral exams. In my case, I had a mixture of the two. I took written exams and I have oral exams that are all a part of the comprehensive exam process or the qualifying exam process. But it really is dependent on your discipline, your department, and even your university. So how do my exams work? Well, I go to UCLA and I'm in the World Arts and Cultures Dance Department, which is an interdisciplinary program. So we don't have what would be called the canon or a canon, which is a set of standard scholars or theories that everybody within our field or discipline has to know. And that fundamentally changes how your exam process works. So if you're in a more traditional or well-established type of discipline or department like anthropology, sociology, or if you have a really well-studied research area like, 17th century literature. I don't know why I always go to 17th century literature, but say that's where you're at. Then there may be a academic canon that you're expected to know. And so when you are in a department like that, then you are expected to know the canon. And most of your exams will probably focus or include a large amount of the canon. So you kind of will already know what to expect the moment that you get on campus because it's a traditional or well-established discipline, research area, what have you. You have an idea of who are the main scholars, theories, and methodologies. But because I'm not in a traditional discipline or department, we have to in our department really demonstrate and define what our field is and then demonstrate that we have knowledge of this constructed field. Our exams are broken into written exams and oral exams. Our written exams are spread across a series of 10 days where we are expected to respond to questions provided by our committee members. And so each of these questions can be anywhere from 15 to 20 pages. And generally there's a minimum of 4 questions. And I imagine a maximum of like 6 because each committee member is expected to have 1 complete question that you have to respond to. Then after you complete your written exams and you've submitted them to your committee member, they review it and then they decide if you pass or fail. There aren't really grades within your PhD exam process, but after you pass in my department, then you go and you have to prepare for your oral exams. Now, oral exams can be at the end of your kind of comprehensive exam process, but it can also be at the end of your final dissertation process. Again, completely dependent on your department. But for us, we do our oral exams right after, or at least the quarter after we completed our written exam. Now, when you think about people talking about oral exams, you'll probably hear the words oral defense, and you are defending your prospectus or your research proposal. And so once you've done your written exams, you should have a good idea of what your field is, what your research is, and its contributions. And so you're expected to write this document called a prospectus. Now, if you have more questions about a prospectus, definitely leave comments down below because I can make a whole video about what a prospectus is, what goes in it, how to write it, things of that nature. But once you have a completed prospectus, then you kind of submit that to your committee members. And with our department, we submit it to our committee members, and then we have to defend it. And so we meet in a room, there's a bunch of questions that go on, and basically they ask, are you prepared? Or they evaluate if you're prepared to go on to this research. Now, this seems like a very daunting part of the examination process, and it can be, but generally this part is one of the most important aspects of our research process because it helps us find the holes or the spaces within our research that we didn't think about and need to resolve before being able to successfully create a project. And so this examination process, again, is a pass or fail, or a pass with revisions. But generally, the whole point is to make sure that you are prepared to go into your dissertation writing process. So your oral defense or your oral exams is less about a test about the field or facts or topics or what have you, and more an examination of your understanding and your ability to complete your dissertation project that is written within your proposal. Now, of course, this doesn't mean that the research proposal that you write is the research proposal that you have to do. Once you are out in the field, things change, you get new information, you meet new people, you learn new things, and so your dissertation project is allowed to morph and look different. But what's most important about our oral defense process is that we are approaching a feasible project, so when we get out in the field, we know what we're doing, and we're not wasting time or just kind of feeling very lost. So don't be stressed out about making the perfect project or having to do exams on a perfect research dissertation or what have you, because it'll change. The point of it is this examination process is really to evaluate your preparedness as a junior scholar going into a research field. Which leads to my next kind of question. What makes these exams different than your undergraduate exams? And it's just that what the purpose of these exams are completely different than the purpose of undergraduate exams. Undergraduate exams are a form of evaluation or assessment to really gauge a specific topic that was discussed or explored within a particular class at a particular time. So they're very narrowed in and specific. A PhD comprehensive exam or qualifying exam, it's much more expansive because you're not demonstrating understanding of a topic, but rather you are demonstrating command of a field. I mean, in short, PhD exams are just more comprehensive. They are really about demonstrating that you not only understand what the theory is, but also who the scholar was, how they're related to other people within your field, what are the tensions or the conflicts within this topic or this conversation, how does this conversation impact other ideas or other concepts, and then taking all of that information and applying it to the world around us or to your research topic specifically. So again, it's not just, you know, what is this theory and why does it matter? It's what is this theory, why does it matter? How does this theory inform this scholar's interpretation of this topic that's related to this, which helps you understand this other thing? So it's a much larger kind of web of understanding in a way that in undergrad, you're really getting to the main topic. What is this? What does it do? Who said it? Why does it matter? And within your PhD, you're definitely pulling that out. It kind of, if you think about it, is really like those kind of detective line drawings with all those strings and stuff attaching so you can get to like the bottom of it. It's that exact process. You're doing that interrogative work within all of the discourse or conversations about a given field or topic or discipline. And then you're taking that information and saying, now that I know all of these things, I'm going to do research to further the conversation in this direction, or to challenge this concept because of this, or to take this conversation back here because I think we did it wrong. And that's completely different. And that's why comprehensive exams are so important, because they're not just evaluating one thing, but really helping you develop as a scholar to be a researcher. I like to tell people when they ask, like, oh, what is the importance of your comps, or why do they matter? It's kind of like a driver's permit. You spend all this time learning how to drive, which would be your coursework, practicing a little bit with small research projects or doing assignments here or there, but you still very much aren't able to kind of go off into the road and explore the world on your own. You're still very much kind of tied to an institution, a very small, particular, safe place. But once you take your comprehensive exams, you move on from just having, you know, those experiences to actually getting the okay, the permit to go and do your own research, to go enter into the field and discover, develop, to examine new things that are 100% from your heart, your soul, your mind. And I think that's what makes comprehensive exams such a big point, because once you pass all of your qualifying exams or comprehensive exams, then you advance to candidacy. And advancing to candidacy is, again, that moment where you transition from being just a PhD student to being a PhD candidate. You're not actually a candidate to be a PhD until you demonstrate that you understand what the field is. So then at that point, once you advance to candidacy and become anything but dissertation, which is ABD, then really what that means is you know enough. It is in this moment that after you've completed your exams that you have the skills to actually do good, ethical, reasonable, validatable research, that you know the theories, so when you write about it, they will come together and make good quality scholarly work, and that you understand the stakes, why it is important, and how to communicate those things. And so again, it's a very big part of your PhD process, because you are transitioning from somebody who hasn't been able to prove themselves to somebody who is a junior scholar, who is considered an academic and just needs to finish their final document, which is the dissertation, to be able to demonstrate that to, you know, future jobs, to the university for the diploma, to your mom or guardian who wanted you to do this since you were two. It just becomes kind of this larger process, and the PhD examination process is the middle part to help you transition into that moment. Now, of course, there are ways to prepare for your PhD comprehensive or qualifying exams, and there are also other things or milestones that go into, you know, becoming a PhD student and what the PhD process are. So if you're interested in hearing more grad life, seeing more grad advice, or everything research, definitely subscribe and check out some past videos. If you have any questions at all about PhD exams or just life in general, leave them in the comments down below. And if you found at least two things in this video useful, definitely hit that thumbs up so others know that this video has good quality content. Your likes, comments, subs really help a small YouTuber like me continue to grow. So thank you so much for watching, and I will see you next week.